See, it's so easy, many of you are already done. I told you. Like anything with computers, if it works, it's really easy. If it doesn't work, then it can take almost an infinite amount of time to figure out what's happening. But this should work pretty readily. One thing you have to watch out for is if you don't actually have these things connected, like you don't actually drag the arrow and actually connect it over there, it'll give you some kind of error. Except for those that are connected. Okay, so did you guys get something that looks like this, I hope, when you plotted it? Someone give me some feedback. Does it look like this when you plot it? Huh? Probably because you started the step change. Go open it up. And yeah, right. So if you started zero, it'll look like that. All right, so this is kind of a weird-looking system, right? Because so far I told you systems will normally look like this, right? Like it goes from one point to another exponentially. This one does something really weird. So first of all, it goes up, and then it goes down, and then it oscillates around and ends up down there. Yeah. Yeah. Right. Right. So the question is, you have this function, and then in MATLAB, you're entering what appears to be the step function in the time domain, right? Because you're entering when it changes and what its magnitude is. So Simulink takes care of all the transformations, yeah. So it actually takes the whole problem that you have and converts it to the time domain when it actually solves it. So when you use the step function, so you know this is the step function, right? So you know this is a function that goes from 0 to 1 at time equal to 0, right? If this was a function that went from 0 to 1 at time equal 5, then you would actually have an e to the minus 5s here. Right, but MATLAB takes care of all that stuff for you. So you're right, in some sense you enter the step function in the time domain, not really in the Laplace domain. Yeah, second question. It's fine.
Is there a way to enter in data as in the Laplace domain?
Well, I mean, you are entering the transfer function in the Laplace domain, but the input, it wants you to enter essentially in the time domain, if you will. Okay. All right, so trying to explain why this weird system looks like this. We're going to learn this. I think you'll learn most of this next Tuesday. Okay. So first of all, you notice it starts at 0 and ends at a negative number. So instead of what I did is I increased the input, but the output didn't go up. The output went down. Okay. That has to do with the so-called steady state gain of the system being negative. So I'll teach you this soon, but the steady state gain is what you get when all the s's are set equal to 0. You can see it's actually minus 1. Okay. So the reason this thing is going negative is because the steady state gain is 0. You can see it people are hyped up. It's oscillating around. Okay, you see it exhibits oscillations, right? That's because this thing is second order, and it's not factorable into real roots. We'll talk about that next time. It's kind of like having a complex conjugate pair of eigenvalues that you may have seen from 361. And the final thing is you notice it's got this curious behavior that it goes kind of in the wrong direction, and then it comes back negative, right? And that has to do with the numerator. Okay? That has to actually do with that minus one. In fact, if you run the simulation again and make that thing a plus one instead of a minus one, okay? So in other words, you change just that thing right there, then you'll find it doesn't, it no longer has this behavior of going kind of in the wrong direction. Yeah. Sure. Let me see if I can show. Is that the one I put together? Okay. So let's just see. We want the step time to be 0, and we want it to go to 1. That's good. Transfer function should be 1. Minus 1, 1, I think, right? And then I want these to go to the workspace. What did I call this, inlet? Or out, input? Thanks for your help, okay. I'll call this guy output. Make sure it's an array, looks good. I don't know how long I should simulate it. What is my plot? I can't see it. I'm gonna cheat and look at my result that I already have to see how long, because I don't want to iterate because I'm lazy. I can see that I plotted it for 15. 15 is a magical canonical number. All right. So there it is. So I'm gonna simulate this for 15 time units. There, I'm going to run it. You see, I got these warnings too. You see this warning? It's not, it doesn't give you a good feeling, but it doesn't really matter. Okay. So warnings typically don't matter. Errors do matter. Okay. So I'm going to just plot T out versus the output. There it is. Okay. So it should be the same thing that you got. Now, if I wanted to demonstrate that you could get rid of that, what I call inverse response thing going in the wrong direction, then I can come into my simulation here. I can change this thing to a plus one. I've got too many of these things open. That's a whole book. Well, by the way, when you guys, you see that little star there? You know what that star means? It means you haven't saved it. And so if you run it, it'll run not what you've done, but what you did. Okay. So if you end up changing something and it didn't change, that usually means you didn't save it before you reran it. Okay. So hit Control S, save this bad boy. No. Maybe it automatically runs. I don't want to save it under a name. Okay. All right. Yeah. So let me correct myself there. It will run without saving the changes, and it will run your changes, but it won't save your changes. So in other words, if you close MATLAB, it'll be the way it was before, which is usually okay. All right. So now my claim is there'll be no inverse response. Let's see if it's true. Come back to MATLAB. I guess I'll hold my previous plot just for kicks. And then I'll plot these guys again. I better give it a different color, maybe red. Okay. So that really changed things. So what did it do? So first of all, when I changed this, I should have changed it the other way. Hold on. When I changed it this way, I not only changed the inverse response, I also changed the directionality. If I didn't want to change the directionality, I should have done this. Okay. Okay. So forget the red one. So what I did in this case was, it used to be this. Okay. This coefficient was minus one. I just made that one also minus one. Because if you do it the other way, it goes in the wrong, goes in the opposite direction, which is the red one. And you can, so if you compare the magenta one, which is a great color in MATLAB, by the way, used for plotting, compared to the blue one, you can see that the behavior is roughly similar, but it no longer has this kind of go the wrong direction behavior called inverse response. Okay. So we're going to talk about all this stuff, a lot of it, on Thursday. How do you know which direction will go up? Like, will it go up or down? That has to do with the steady state gain. How do you know if the system will oscillate or not oscillate? That has to do with the roots of that polynomial. Has to do with the roots of this polynomial we'll talk about. And then the final thing is, how do you know if it'll go kind of in the opposite direction, have its inverse response? That has to do with the roots of this polynomial, the numerator, which we'll talk about. Okay? So you guys are free to go, or you can play around with your simulation.